Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to another practical session here at the Vol University of Technology. And we are focusing on engineering circuits and the engineering practicals that is being presented as part of the subjects. Today, I want to carry on with the idea of how to use a breadboard. In a previous video, we have taken some time to identify the various aspects of a breadboard. And just to run through for those of you who haven't seen it yet, you have the red and the blue and the red at the bottom. And then these connections are running right through, from left to right, all the way from that side to this side, and the same here for the two rails at the bottom. The holes in the middle are five holes up and down, five holes up and down. So keep in mind that when we should use an integrated circuit, an IC or so, that's typically how we will place it. And the idea then is the reference pin 1, let me show you a small thing, reference pin 1 this side, 2, 3, 4, and then on top 5, 6, 7, 8. So you always count anti-clockwise with the reference or the notch sitting on your left hand side. Take note, the red line is on top, the blue line is at the bottom for the two inner rails. And we are going to use that as power because it's indicated plus and minus. We often see students using the breadboard like this, and then they lose marks. And they cannot understand why do they fail the practicals. Well, simply put, they're not using the component or the hardware as it is designed to be used. And for that reason, because they are not conforming to the electrical standards that relates to the use of a breadboard, we have to deduct the marks. Even though your circuit might be working electrically, and even if you get results, you will never get 100% if you present a breadboard used in this orientation to the lecturer. Most guys use now this rails here for positive and something down here for negative, and they ignore the sidelines completely. So that doesn't fly. Right, back to the topic. We're going to do the circuit of a common emitter amplifier. All electronics 2 students are confronted with this circuit from time to time. The circuit has got a bit of theory that is extensively done and treated in the theory class, and it boils down to the following. The circuit will have an AC equivalent circuit whereby it looks slightly different than the normal constructed circuit. The reason is the capacitors become short circuit and the VCC power also short circuit itself. So in essence, this ground, this ground, this ground, that ground all connect to itself, and that is a simplified version of the circuit. But in the real world, when we are going to apply signals to our practical measurements, we will never construct a second circuit because we need the capacitors, we need the power supply. You cannot leave him out and think it's going to give you the same results. So step one to make a note for yourself is the AC is just an equivalent circuit representing the electrical processes that is happening. So we're going to look at figure 9.2 for the common emitter amplifier. It's a very standard circuit, and I'm going to zoom in a little bit, make sure it's in the frame. But it's a very standard circuit. It's one of the first type of amplifiers that is usually encountered. And just to highlight a couple of things about it is the following. The instruction says it's got a DC and AC analysis. So the theory guys, you're going to do the mathematics using this circuit. You're going to physically measure each value of resistor that is handed out to you in the lab. Write down what is your measured value. Use that measured value to do the calculation to compute the DC parameters. And once you know that, the measurements can be, or that results can be written down into table 9.2. That gives me a reference. It gives me something to strive towards. It gives me something to compare my physical measurements that I will actually have. And once I have compared these two values here, I know whether my circuit is working correctly or not. So that's the reasoning behind this process. So I just want to show you guys today how to construct the circuit. This is the circuit, figure 9.2. It consists of a signal generator. Now that is not a physical component, it's an instrument. And in one of our previous videos, we did show you guys how to set up the audio generator for this experiment. So in essence, this, with my finger covering that instrument, This is where we start with the circuit. We have a transistor. You've got R1, R2, RC, which is your collector resistor, and then RE is split into two, RE1 and RE2, with a bypass capacitor here, C2, on the emitter side. The output of the transistor goes through C3, and that is presented to a load resistor. So that's the circuit. Basically, VCC will be an external power supply. Ground, 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 ground are all connected together. So it's not five different points that you will have on the breadboard. It will be a single point that is on the breadboard. So I'm going to leave this one in this position. And then just to remind you, one can have small breadboards or even the full size one. It doesn't matter which one you use. What does matter is make sure your red lines is on top and the blue line here is the inner line at the bottom. That usually orientates your numbering from left to right. Number 1 to 5, 15, 20, all those rows are here and they are connected up, down and they are insulated by this valley that is in the middle. So, let's start with the transistor. The transistor, according to the circuit, says it should be a 3904. And if we look very carefully, a bit of our focus, maybe I can convince the technology here. That's it, 39. That's a wonderful camera, I must say. 3904. Doesn't matter which fabricate that you used, but the transistor must have this number. Do not use the 3906, that is for the next experiment. So, in order to use it, we open the legs. And then from the data sheet, we know that where is the emitter, the base, and the collector. The idea is you would like to orientate the transistor more or less according to the circuit itself. So, putting it in like this is a possible solution. So we can do it like that. Okay, so now I've got collector on top, base in the middle, emitter on this side. Alright, very nice that you do it. Then secondly, we're going to look at components, and our first component should be a 10 kilo ohm resistor. 5 points to the guy at the back who shouted brown, black, orange, very nice. And that resistor must go now from the base. And remember, the components have got legs. Use it. Don't put extra wires. Wires just add to your frustration at some point. So the base going to positive. Base going to positive, to VCC. 10K. 10K, doesn't matter which way around we put the resistor, because it's not polarized. The next resistor I'm looking for would be a 4K7. That would be yellow, purple, red. A yellow, purple, red. Nice. That one goes from the base, it plugs in there, maybe it was a bit stiff, but it doesn't matter, and this little resistor can stick in there. Then we notice there is a 1 microfarad capacitor, C1. So I look for the capacitor, 1 microfarad, very nice, and check the polarity. The positive is this side where the biasing is happening. On the capacitor there is a marking, a big minus. That minus tells me this is the negative side of the capacitor. It's an electrolytic capacitor, which means the polarity makes a difference. And it helps us to make the circuit correct. So I plug it into the same line as the base, and at this point it just goes to nowhere. Remember, my finger is still on that external instrument that is to be connected in a later stage. But for now, I've now done 1, 2, 3 components, 4 including the transistor. Very nice. On the emitter side, we have a very creative circuit that we need to look at, and we are looking for 100 ohm and 330. So 100 is brown, black, brown. And that one goes to the emitter, and it goes somewhere like this. You can put it anywhere, doesn't need to be exactly the same as mine, but if you orientate it like that, you will not make a mistake. The idea of your orientation of the circuit is, let your circuit look more or less like the diagram. If you do that, you are solving a lot of problems for yourself in the near future. RE2, 330, that is orange, orange, brown. RE2, I plug it in here, going to ground. Very nice. Then we have a capacitor, which should be the 47 microfarad capacitor, and if I can just find it, I can use it. Alright, okay, there it is. So, that capacitor goes parallel to RE2, so it doesn't go to the emitter. Some students would now plug it in here and say, wait, wait, it is fine. Then I say, no, no, it doesn't work. You are bypassing both resistors at the same time. That should not happen. What I do is, I do it according to the circuit. This one, C2, is now connected parallel to RE2. And you notice that three pins here are in the same position, they're in the same line of five holes in order to make 1, 2, 3 connections to the same point. 1, 2, 3. So RE1, RE2, and the leg of the capacitor to the same point. So to do 3 points at one, it is 1, 2, 3 holes and it is a vertical. If you put it next to each other, it will not connect. That means you are failing the use of the breadboard. Big problem. On the collector side, that would now be on the top of the transistor. That side, we need to install a 1 kilo ohm resistor. And they are here. 1 kilo ohm resistor, brown, black, red. Bend the legs nicely. You notice I don't use special tools or nothing. I don't use my teeth. I simply just take the component as it is given to me and I use it. So, we've got now 1K, 10K, 4K7, 330 ohm, 100 ohm, C1, C2, and then we need C3. C3 is also a 1 microfarad capacitor. If I can find it, I can use it. Now, once again, ask yourself, what side is the energy? Is the energy going to be on the load, or is the energy coming from this circuit here? And simply put, this side is where the DC is. This side, there's nothing, because the capacitor will block the DC. So the negative must be on the load resistor side. So the short leg comes this side, the long leg goes to the collector. And then, making sure you don't have a parallax fault, you simply take that component, and I'm going to stretch it open a little bit just to make it easier for my lab technician to identify the circuit. And voila, now I've done that. The negative side comes this side. Positive is towards the collector of the transistor, towards the resistor. So those three are in the same line. And then we need a 10 kilo ohm resistor because that is our load. Remember, a common emitter amplifier has got a high output impedance. And that's why we use a 10 kilo ohm resistor. Now, be careful. Do not just plug it in crossing that bridge. Because this side, this leg, is not connecting to negative. And because it's not connecting to negative, this thing is now not connected to anywhere. So we want it to connect to ground, which must means I must move it and put it to the blue line. So if I have the blue line there, I've got this, that is C3. So my V out, I will measure across my load resistor. V in, I will measure it right here on my input. And when we do the circuit, it is like that. So what is left? A red wire and a black wire. You will notice that this says the whole circuit has been constructed with no components whatsoever. No wires whatsoever. What am I smoking? So we put down the black wire for negative, 0 volts, or ground. The common of the circuit, and the red one goes to red, and that is there. There's nothing else we need to do. From here, we can now apply the instruments, we can apply the oscilloscope, and we can actually go as far as switching it on, and it should work and give us the results that we are expecting. To recap, make sure VCC is in your red line on top. Ground is in the blue line at the bottom. Do not orientate your breadboard like this. You are crazy if you are doing that, and you are going to be penalized in terms of your results and your marks. Orientate the board like this. Then count your circuits, count your components in the circuit. So I see C1, C1, C2, C2, C3, C3. Make sure that your connections, when you are working in these sections, are vertically orientated. 1, 2, 3 components connected, 1, 2 components connected, 1, 2, 3 components connected here, 1, 2, 3, just two components because it's just that leg and this leg, and on the base side, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4 components connected together. If you don't do it like that, and if you don't double check yourself, you are going to have a hard time making the circuit work. Alright, I hope that clarifies the method of how to make a circuit. So common emitter is an example. Second practical is common collector, and then we've got the filter circuit as well. But apply this method and you will be successful with all of the circuits. Thank you.